I'm very grateful to have been raised in a very religious household. I really got a good sense of morality and a really good moral compass and a good moral foundation from that. But the reason why I have chosen to distance myself is because I did notice that there are certain hypocrisies that I, at this point in my life, really can't endorse. In the faith, there is an expectation of men who have come from all walks of life, including one of the most revered men, Malcolm X, who in the bibliography talks about his past where, you know, he was an addict. He did heavy narcotics, you know, made money from scamming, made money from pimping women, made money, you know, even from prostituting himself to both men and women. And this is not me slandering the man. This is open. This is something that anybody can research and find out, that this is a part of his story. And I don't look down on his journey by any stretch of the imagination, because people go through what they go through at their points of ignorance. If they knew better, they would do better, including him. And what I had an issue with was that the mistakes that I had made in life, there was no room, there was no wiggle room as a woman to make certain mistakes in your life and still be embraced both by men and by women. And I noticed that there was just tremendous hypocrisy that if a woman slipped up, she was forever damaged. And, you know, she was had to basically endure the consequence of, you know, her life mistakes by, you know, whatever, forever being single or forever being alone to raise her child. That was the consequence. But if a man could mess up in way bigger ways, and there would be endless forgiveness. And the same thing that we talk about when we talk about, you know, the White House, how people are really, really disgusted by these boys' clubs, are the same boys' clubs that you find within certain communities, including the conscious community, where there's just all of these hypocrisies where men can literally come from the streets, be dope dealers, pimp women, do whatever they want, and still be allowed into this brotherhood, whereas women had to walk a very fine line, so on and so forth. And so I understood it from a historical standpoint, but looking at the dynamics, the current dynamics, I said, this is something that really shouldn't be applicable when so many women are abandoned and left to raise their children on their own, figure it all out, you know, be their emotional and financial and mental support on their own. And the idea of like a lot of, just like a lot of things, like in the conscious community, you know, people talking about women's like hairstyles or like, you know, very like trivial aesthetic things, but not talking about things that are like really impactful and meaningful. Like, wow, let's start a movement to create, you know, men to be there for their wives and their children, and be better husbands and be better fathers. And let's do challenges that, you know, force men to discipline themselves so they don't ruin their families by, you know, going outside of their marriage. Like, why is there no effort for that? But yet women are continuously picked apart. And what people also have to realize is that we are creating the world that we are living in, and we're also creating the world for the future. And so a lot of these men have daughters. And the question is, do you want your daughters to live in toxic masculinity? Do you want your daughters to be groomed and reared and then have very few choices as far as suitable life partners? I mean, these are the questions that you should be asking yourself, because the legacy is not ending right here and right now. It's going to continue with the work that we're doing. And so this is the reason why I've chosen more of a spiritual path and less of a religious path. And I am, you know, I don't like labels, and I'm not going to say that I'm a feminist specifically, but I do, you know, I was raised by a single mother who worked her ass off to be able to give us a life. by herself and had to endure all that that entailed. And so, yeah, that's what I know. That's who I was raised by. I know that there's a lot of women, you know, I'm not famous, I'm not a celebrity. And, you know, I know that there's probably a lot of women that wish that they could speak freely, but because of the positions that they're in, they cannot. Another thing that I wanted to address is not just this gender war and toxic masculinity, but also this war that we have between women. And I know that a lot of women are coming together and we're uniting, and that's beautiful. But I believe that in order for us to progress, we have to also reconcile our past. And there's a lot of issues between white women and black women. And I was raised in, you know, a household where some of my best friends growing up were white. I was also raised in a household where my grandmother was the only one in our village, married to a Caucasian man. He was Swiss. So my aunt is half West African and half Swiss, raised in West Africa. And my grandmother's explanation always was, hey, when I cut myself, the same blood that I bleed, you know, is the same blood that he bleeds. And this man was so good to her. He took care of her and he loved her more than any man had ever, you know, loved her. And this is my background. This is my environment. This is how I was raised. So I wasn't raised in an totally, I guess you could say, homogenized environment. And I was raised very open-minded. Like I said, my best friends, you know, big shout out to Amanda. She's probably one of the best friends that I've ever had in my entire life. Took me into her home. We got to go to Cape Cod together. Just a wonderful, compassionate Pisces. So, you know, they're big-hearted girl. But growing up, as I became an adult, I realized that, especially in the restaurant industry, some of the worst treatment that I ever had was by the hands of white women. And it was something that really was confusing to me because of the way that I grew up and the friends that I had that were so loving, so amazing, and really treated me like a sister. It was confusing when I got older into the real world that there was just such cruelty done at the hands of white women. And when I went to college, I was a, you know, communication major, and I minored in black studies. And I started studying, you know, things that my grandmother didn't tell me, where literally, you know, women, black women in America were raped and carrying children and also forced to nurse white babies. And all of the injustice of slavery, and there was no unification among women. There was no compassion where the white woman said, no, you know, as a woman, we're not going to allow you to do this to women. It was exploiting. It was condescending. It was treating black women with a lack of dignity. And working in a subservient position for so long, I had to realize that these things were still going on. And it was almost as if there was resentment or animosity towards me. Like, all the other black girls put up with us treating them like shit. Why don't you? And so, you know, a lot of times all the black girls would come to me and talk to me and say, hey, you know, this person's racist and this person's really treating us unfairly. And I was always the scapegoat. I always was the person who was defending everybody. I guess you could say like the Harriet Tubman of like the restaurant industry. And I got to a point where I said, you know, it's time for people to stick up for themselves. But a lot of our oppression, both historically and currently, have been at the hands of white women, and there's been absolutely no path of reconciliation. And I'm not going to speculate why, but I do believe that maybe it is that if there's no incentive to reconcile, like no monetary incentive, like, okay, well, you know, socially and socioeconomically, you people are on the bottom, so what good would it do us for us to try and reconcile with you? Because there's just been no effort whatsoever to reconcile. The last straw that broke the camel's back for me, which was another decision why I said I'm never gonna bartend and I'm never gonna work inside of this industry again. I was working at this restaurant, Nobu, DC. And I'm not gonna slander Nobu, because from what I understand, it's not just an incredible restaurant internationally, but there's a lot of branches that they do the right thing. It really wasn't a matter of the brand. It wasn't a matter of the food. It had nothing to do with that whatsoever. It was a general manager, who I believe is still currently there, who was despicably and disgustingly racist and made me go through all types of humiliation and just, like, I would look in her eyes, like, how do you feel okay? Like, all of the managers, like, all of the women managers, like, how do you feel okay doing this? How do you feel okay treating another human being like this? And then you want to donate to different charities and, you know, talk about all these charities of, like, foster kids and things like that, but you treat a single mother who has to provide for her kid like shit. And my higher nature says, you know what, you can't judge people in their ignorance. You still have to open your heart to love. But at the same time, it's like, I would love to be able to get past all of these things, but there's been absolutely no effort to reconcile our differences. If anything, it's just gotten more covert. And I would love to be able to embrace other women that don't look like me, just like I embraced, you know, Amanda, Lauren, and Lee, all the girls that I grew up with. I would love for us to be able to have that sisterhood. However, it just hasn't turned out that way. And it hasn't been on my end. It hasn't been the energy that I've been bringing to the table. It's been the energy that they've been bringing to the table and being so condescending and so belittling and, you know, all of these assumptions about someone's, you know, education or lack thereof and all of these ways that we've been historically and currently oppressed. And the reason why I'm choosing to speak on this is I know that there's a lot of women who aren't in the position to speak on it, even like celebrities, like, you know, the disunification of the Black family has been largely because of certain people putting things together to make sure that, you know, we don't stay intact as a family unit. And I know that, you know, I'm sure that, you know, Oprah, Michelle Obama, and Beyonce, like, I'm sure that, you know, many Black women of a certain level can talk about various ways that they've been mistreated at the hands of white women along their journey. And, you know, I'm sure that they probably have these conversations in private, but because of their brands and because of their money and things like that, they probably aren't at liberty to talk about it as freely as I am. But my point being is that I really do want there to be harmony, but there has to be reconciliation before there can be harmony. And there has to be an admittance of wrongdoings and mistreatment before there can really truly be harmony. And so that's, you know, a couple of things that I wanted to get off of my chest. I believe ultimately that love is the highest power, it's the highest force. And I also believe that, just like my grandma said, you know, love can conquer all. If you happen to fall in love with somebody, and this is for men and women, if you happen to fall in love with somebody who doesn't look like you, but that person gives you all the love and the nurturing and the support that you need, I'll never knock that. Whether you're a Black man who decides to, you know, fall in love with a white woman and marry a white woman, well, you know, maybe she embodies the level of compassion for you that you need to heal your wounds from a lot of oppression that's been placed on you. And Black women as well, I believe that if you find somebody, if you are looking, you know, and you're lonely and you're continuously looking for a Black man, but you can't find a Black man who's able to nurture you and have the level of compassion that you need to continue your journey and go along with your life and your healing process and whatever it is that you're embarking on, I say by all means, you know, find somebody who may not look like you, who's able to understand you and give you respect and love and compassion. And I'll close out with this. I'll never forget, I was watching this thing on TV. It was called, you know, Wife Swap. And I want to say it was Jackie. She's an actress and a comedian. And then there was another lady of Caucasian descent, and they did the wife swap. And Jackie went to the lady's husband and said, I don't know if you know, but, you know, your wife was really known in the industry as being very promiscuous and being somewhat of a hoe. And the man said, you know, this woman has endured all types of trauma, and she, you know, had gone through, like, I don't know if it was like rape or molestation, and it really messed up her mind. And he said that she was completely open about her background with him, and that made him love her even more. And he came from a standpoint of compassion, saying, I know that things have happened to you, and I know that, you know, your mind and your mental state may have been traumatized, and you may have, you know, done certain things in the past, but I love you anyways, regardless. And to me, that's true love. And so don't stop until you're able to find somebody who loves you in your entirety, whether they are black, white, pink, blue, no matter what their nationality is or their creed or whatever. Like, if you find somebody that loves your heart and loves you in your entirety, loves your idiosyncrasies, loves your good, your bad, your great, your dark side, everything, then that's the person that you stick with. And I'm no master of love, but on my journey, these are the lessons that I've collected. Peace and happy Thanksgiving. Love to all.